Hi, my name is Chris, and today I'll be making my chocolate chip cookies. A lot of people like for some reason, I don't know why. My inspiration is caramel flavoring, essentially, but naturally. So, in keeping with Alton Brown, we've got hardware and we've got software. The hardware is cookie drying racks. Three air baked cookie sheets. Not sure if it has to be air bake. Three quarters, 1 cup, 2 cup, 2 small spoons, 1 large spoon, 1 half teaspoon, measuring spoon. Two of the most important hardware items are a very sharp spatula. Metal is best. And a KitchenAid. I'm sure you can do similar. You can get similar results with not exactly what I've got, but this is what I've used. Okay, software. None of these brands are important. What matters is the ingredients themselves. So the recipe I'll be following is on one of these. This is Costco brand. The recipe's on the back, and there'll be slight modifications to it. So, dark brown sugar, any old butter will do. We've tried Kerrygold, we've tried browning butter, that doesn't really help. Salt, I personally like unbleached flour. It is important for all purpose. We've tried bread flour, that didn't turn out very well. Baking soda. I really like these chips and the recipes on them. We've tried Hershey's, we've tried Nestle, we've tried Ghirardelli. We like these the best, or Trader Joe's, but the recipe again is from here. Okay, one of the more important ingredients. You'll notice there's no white sugar at all. So we want either, it doesn't, again, brand doesn't matter. Sugar in the raw, or it doesn't matter if it's a Costco brand or Mexican sugar. The important thing is flavor. Plain white sugar just adds sweetness, there's no flavor. It adds a caramely flavor. Again, this is not. I'm not expecting anyone to have anything like this. I use the sugar that's in here. You'll notice there are some black things in here, which are essentially drying vanilla beans. So this is vanilla-infused sugar. I think it helps, but not 100% necessary. So recipe is 2 sticks of butter. 1 cup packed down dark brown sugar, 3/4 of the sugar in the raw. And that's it because the creaming process, we need to make sure that those ingredients are really, really smooth. Okay, we're back. Okay, so again, 2 sticks of butter, 3/4 cup. Mexican or raw sugar and 1 cup of brown sugar packed. So we really need to get this smooth. It really helps to have softened butter. This butter is not at all softened at all. So we're going to take a break because this is not coming together at all. And what we're going to do before we take a break is I'm actually going to put this on the oven right next to the vent, and that will actually soften this up really well. So we want this really creamed and really soft before we put any more ingredients in it. We'll be back. Okay, we're back. So 10 minutes later, on a 200 degree oven sitting on the vent, you'll notice that it's getting a little melted. So, let's try this again. We want, again, we want smoothness with just these three ingredients and no others before we continue. It's coming together a little bit better. It needs more time. A lot of people don't do this, but I do. So, I think we're gonna pause here and come back after another 5-10 minutes. Okay, we're back again. Another 10 more minutes. So notice the brownness. It's looking very liquid. The sugar will melt under heat. We don't want completely liquid, just a little bit liquid to bring it together with the butter, which I believe is called creaming. So, try this again. That's looking a lot better. Once that's smooth, then I can start adding the rest of the wet ingredients. Yeah, that's gonna work. Okay, next ingredients are, a little bit more creamy. Okay, next ingredients are 2 eggs. Wet ingredients specifically. The recipe calls for 1 tablespoon of vanilla. I don't need 1 tablespoon because I've got vanilla infused sugar. That came out way faster than I wanted. I really only do about 1.5 teaspoons, but too much vanilla can't be that. It's not gonna be a problem. Okay, so mixing the dry. 2 cups of flour. I don't sift. I don't bother. Notice it's still mixing while I'm pouring. Normally I only have 1/2 teaspoon. Normally I pre-measure the dry, and so when I get my teaspoon wet, I don't have to rinse it off and re-dry it. Okay, 1 teaspoon of, and that's the reason why you don't use a wet teaspoon. One teaspoon of baking soda, 1/2 teaspoon of sugar, salt, whatever this is. Definitely don't measure this over the dry. Measure it over the sink. You don't want an accident in your dry. Try to distribute that a little bit. Okay, take a look at. So that's what it really should look like before you start putting in the dry. If this does not come together very well, if it's clumpy, I'll actually put the batter back on the oven and get it warmer. It looks like this is warm enough. So at this point, it's just gonna be friction that's gonna warm it up enough to come together. I'm going to... Okay, another bit of hardware. Spatula, helpful. Just It's not perfect, so just any of the ingredients that are not wanting to come off the paddle, please help them. Also the sides. Again, key here is uniformity, smoothness, all of that. It's looking really good, actually. Okay, so I have people in my life that like these cookies without chocolate chips. I prefer the chocolate chips, other people do not. I will typically do a dozen without the chips. This typically makes 4.5 dozen, or about 50 some cookies. The recipe calls for 2 cups of chips. I will take out a dozen cookies without chips. And so the ones that have chips will have a lot more chips. So, okay. After cleaning up a bit, this has come out really well. Notice it's even moving as it's leaning over. Recipe calls for 375. The oven has not come up to temperature yet. But that's fine because you can pre-cookie the sheets. So the typical method is the 2 small spoons are to spoon out cookie amounts of batter. Again, I typically try to do a dozen per sheet until I run out of batter, and then typically the last sheet is usually some fraction thereof. Okay, so the large spoon finally comes into play. Typically don't like to use the KitchenAid to mix in the chips. It's not necessary. And I do this whole chipless and chipped version. So not using these small spoons because they can bend. This is very, very soft batter. You can get a different consistency, a different texture by actually refrigerating the batter for several hours, but then you have to bring it back up to temperature again just to put the chips back in, if you're gonna do that. If you don't want chipless and you just want chips in your batter, you could do this, then put it in the refrigerator and bring it out, and you wouldn't have my problem. So, that's good enough. The oven still is not up to temperature yet. And now it's kicking out some stuff we've baked in the past, and it's making it hard to breathe, so that's special. So, same thing with the two small spoons, and I'm gonna start coughing because the oven is really cranking out some smoke. You can't see it, but you can smell it. You want to make these as uniform as you can. So try to do it as similar as you can, and if you're doing the same similar technique, theory is you'll come out with similar sizes. Okay, so we definitely don't want them running into each other, so make sure there's a little bit of space between them all. I'm gonna turn off the light so I can look at what the temperature is. It's up to temperature. So two racks. Should be pretty far apart. You don't want the cookies touching the rack, obviously. I do these in rotation. So I'm gonna put the chipless first because they actually need to cook less. So first rotation, I'm going to set 4 minutes and 15 seconds. At 4 minutes, 15 seconds, I will put the top rack onto the bottom rack and put in the next set of cookies. While you're waiting, prepare the next. Cookie sheet. And now I am totally breaking what I said earlier and getting completely ununiform amounts on my spoons. The other thing I'm breaking is this looks, this batter is really soft, so I think more batter is actually coming out on the spoons. Normally it's 4.5 dozen, but I'm looking at this and I'm only seeing 3 dozen and change. So whatever, it'll still be fine. So again, now we wait for 2 minutes and 40 seconds. Okay, the timer's about to go off and then we will rotate. So once this train has left the station, you really need to be prepared to make cookies, rotate, and take them off the cookie sheets. So, yeah, these are a little bit larger than normal. Okay, so as soon as you do that, do not forget to set your timer again. You will have charcoal briquettes if you forget. I can guarantee you when you get distracted and the timer doesn't go off for 10 more minutes, you'll be very sad. We got 20 seconds on the clock. Okay, so this is going to be a lot of action. As soon as the timer goes off, I want my drying racks, cooling racks, drying, cooling, whatever they're doing, very, very close, 5 seconds. Also, once the cookies come off the drying racks, we will want to put them in cookie tins. All right, so these are done. This one goes in here. This one goes in here. Set the timer. This is where the sharp spatula really comes in handy. These come right off, or not. Or these are very, very soft. These are softer than I'm used to. Not sure why that happens sometimes. I'm sure the cookie on the floor of the counter will taste just fine. It may just not look very good. So, yeah. I made these way bigger than normal. These come out much smaller. So anyway, notice how I'm doing this to not kill these cookies. Is upside down. That gets very hot really quickly. I like to rotate my what are those things are called? What are those things called?
Oven mitts.
Yeah, those. Oven mitts. So again, somehow this makes way more cookies normally. I made way larger cookies. Obviously that will make less cookies. And we're almost done at 6. So again, take the cookies out, put the cookies in, set the timer, take the cookies off the current finished cookie sheet, and then put the new batter on the now empty cookie sheet. I might as well finish off the batter in here. And before you know it, your timer will go off. So don't get distracted, don't do anything else. 4.5 minutes is not very much time when you're doing all of this all at the same time. 20 more seconds, and we do the same rotation dance. The spatula with the chocolate chips is a little bit more challenging than without the chocolate chips. So. These are, these are too big. Eh, who cares? Far-baked cookies are tasty, right? So, I made a snap decision. You leave these in too long, they will burn, they will not be tasty. I personally like an unbaked cookie versus a overbaked cookie. 4.5 minutes back on the clock. So again, if you can, rotate out your oven mitts. This gets very hot trying to hold this thing. Oh, wow. Yeah. That's gonna be, oh boy. Well, that's fun. So yeah. So, lesson learned here. When the cookies are, the larger the cookie, the longer they need to bake. This may be a little too par-baked, or not, a little less par-baked than most people would like, but I'm okay with it. So, again, a very, very sharp spatula, hardly any cookie left on the spatula. Very easy to get them off. So, we've got a minute left on the clock, but you, again, need to be ready and prepared. We've got drying racks, cooling racks, whatever the hell they are, full of cookies. I can't put any cookies on those. So, so you don't want to take these off immediately. They have to cool a bit, but you definitely need to take them off soon enough that you are ready to actually deal with the timer going off. So, 17 seconds. You don't really have to do this, but in the order or in... in the interest of consistency, last one out, previous one down, I'll actually put the empty one in. Again, most of these cookies are cooking with two cookie sheets in the oven. So, 4.5 minutes on the clock before I do anything else. Swap out my oven mitts. I don't want to burn myself doing this. If your spatula gets dirty, if there's too much cookie on the spatula, clean it off before you start trying to do a new batch. Yeah, these cookies are not going to be... these are not going to be circles. Wow. Normally, they do look more like cookies than little shriveled sticks. That is when you don't have a very sharp spatula, that will happen. Again, you want to get completely under the cookies. And out of my hands before it burns me. Okay, so that's pretty much it. The rest are coming out the same way, same technique as I've done the whole time. These are gonna be really soft. They're just bare. Wow. Yeah. So these are gonna take a little bit to dry or to cool, to harden up. They will harden up as they get cooler. Obviously, this one is cooler. If you take them off the cooling racks too soon, they will break. So keep that in mind. I need to figure out what to do with these in the next 2.5 minutes. So hopefully they don't turn out like this. So the smaller the cookie, the more uniform, the more cookie it will be and less like a stick. So keep that in mind. I made a mistake with the size of a batter on my spoons today. Probably because I felt like I was in a hurry to do the video. So, let me know how these turn out for you, wherever this shows up. See ya.